Well, I mean, I think if spiritual enlightenment was only open to the rich would be hopefully a lot better people than they are. So I don't think they're necessarily linked. But I think, you know, I have people ask me a lot of the time questions along the lines of, you know, how can I possibly, I can't afford to do what you did. I can't afford to go and take a year off from my work, from my family, from my obligations, from the contracts, the social contracts that I have with people, or the illness that I'm taking care of, or, you know, whatever the things are that hold people into the places where they're staying, you know, and they say, I can't afford to do that in any way, in any definition of the word afford, you know, so how can I have the experiences that you had? And I think it would be insulting for me to walk around telling people that they could do that, you know, because the reality is that even in my life, which has been a life that's I've got a lot of freedom. I don't have children. I've been lucky enough to have a career that facilitates travel. You know, I'm healthy. Even in my life, there was only one moment when I could have done that, and it was that year. I couldn't do it now. You know, I'm way too entrenched in the lives of people around me to do it again. And I have one of the freest schedules of anybody on earth. You know, so it's, and I also don't think everybody should do that, you know. I have a friend, one of my favorite moments before I left on this trip, this editor friend of mine in New York said to me, wow, you're going to an ashram for 4 months to meditate. There's a part of me that so wishes that I wanted to do that, but I really, really have no desire for it whatsoever. You know, he's got to find his way and a different path. But I do think there are people who long for that. And all I can think of is that, you know, if the only people who had spiritual enlightenment available to them are those who could afford a plane ticket to India, the world would be an even more unfair place than it already is. And the example that I always think of is this friend of mine from high school. Actually, he was my prom date, who's in prison now, as my mom predicted at the time. But anyway, he's having the spiritual experience of a lifetime because he's using that time to focus on meditation and contemplation and self-transformation. And he's in an 8x8 foot room where every minute of his day is sort of organized by other people. I would argue that it's probably easier to find time to meditate in prison than it is if you have two little kids at home, you know, and you're also sort of holding down a job and struggling with a lot of other issues. But I have to believe, because it would warp too much my understanding of humanity, that questions of divinity are available to anybody, and that the entrance to those questions are everywhere. And certainly evidence shows that. You know, people have transcendent religious experiences in refugee camps. They have them in traffic jams. They have them during war. They have them at their offices. You know, these invitations arrive in people's lives wherever they are. And I was lucky enough, for a lot of reasons, to be able to carve out this huge period of time to go to this very special place and do this work in a really organized way. But my spiritual practices today, you know, in my life in New Jersey, are nothing compared to a lot of people I know who have much busier lives than me, who insist on making time for this. You know, they wake up at 4 o'clock in the morning and they hold that time sacred, and they work at it and they meditate, and they didn't have any of the advantages that I have, and they are way, way, way closer to the destination that I was seeking, merely on account of the fact that they're demanding it, whether they live in Queens or, you know, Indiana.